I'm really glad that we started this, you know, coming together to study the word. Let's just put a little light on the subject first. There we go. Old, young, sitting around this table. It's all about inspiring each other, drawing each other closer to God. And I do hope that through our Bible studies, someone else, near and far, will be drawn closer to him too.
Now the Bible says the serpent was more subtle, and another translation would render it deceptive, crafty, you know? So this verse gives us an introduction to who Satan really is. He's crafty. And let none of us think that within our own strength or our own wisdom, we can contend against the devil.
He's a perfect being. God did not make imperfect beings. Mm-hmm. So how do you move from a perfect being to one of the greatest adversaries this world has, this entire universe has ever seen?
The Bible means different realities to different individuals. Mm-hmm. For some people, it's a book like any other book in the library. And for some people, it's more than just a book. It is what reveals God to them. And they are very concerned, very committed to the teachings of the Bible.
I want to stop you right here because I know you're a little further than I want you to, because I want to hear. I know, it's just 3:1, just 3:1 for now, you know.
And verse 14 outlined that it was an anointed cherub that covered, and it suggested that he actually covered God.
Like, now she started to think beyond God's word.
This is something I got from you, actually. There's God. Human beings, they sin, they are away from God. No, there's a gap, and I guess a gap can be called sin.
Except thee, so thou wast upon the holy mountain of God, thou wast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
If you don't say what I'm thinking, I want to say it after.
That old serpent, he had some history to him, right? Mm-hmm.
Jesus came, be God and man to redeem man, and when he comes back, he's going to bring them back together. And what are you saying? I got it from you.
These are awesome times. God, it's all in your hands.
It's easy to be overtaken by doubt, especially in times like these. And you may sometimes feel that God can't possibly use you if you've ever had doubts. The story of Gideon in Judges 6 shows us differently. Gideon was called upon by God to deliver Israel from its enemies. Even though God had promised to be with Gideon, he was still so filled with doubt that he asked God for proof of what he said, twice. And God graciously granted it. This reminds me that God is patient with us when we seek Him in earnest truth. 1 Chronicles 16:11 tells us to seek the Lord and His strength, seek His face continually. And Proverbs 3 verse 5 says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In these trying times, let us seek and let us trust.
Sabbath, friends. My name is Hugh Saunders, and welcome to another Friday evening Sabbath School lesson review. From the beginning of May, we have been looking at the overarching theme, how to interpret the Bible. And this week, lesson 10, we'll be looking at the Bible and history. But before we do, let us breathe a word of prayer. Everlasting Father, we thank you for the Sabbath. We thank you for the ability to read your scriptures. We thank you for the Holy Spirit who you have sent to comfort us and to help us to interpret scripture. We pray that as we review this lesson, that the messages in it may be clear to all, and that at the end of it, all will be edified and be encouraged or inspired to be heirs to your kingdom and also be stronger in their faith. We thank you for hearing and answering our prayers. In your name I pray. Amen. So the memory text for this week comes to us from Exodus 20 verse 2, and it says, I am the Lord your God, who has brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Let us pause for a while and look at this memory text, because I was wondering, how does it augment the topic? What was the author thinking when they chose this text to be the overarching text for the Bible and history? In looking at the text closely, we see that I am the Lord, that phrase literally means I am Yahweh, and Yahweh is a form of the Hebrew verb to be. Hence, it means the one who is, or the self-existent one. The verb can also be in the positive form,
and therefore can mean the one who causes everything to be. So here the author of history, who is God, is reminding the people of Israel that he is the self-existent one who has caused everything to be. But God is bringing them back to the beginning of time, the beginning of his story as recorded in Genesis 1. And that's interesting because last week we were looking at creation. So this is like a beautiful segue into what we're about to study about the Bible and history. In looking at the second part of the text, brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage, God is reminding them of the most recent history, because at this point they are at Mount Sinai. He's delivering the Ten Commandments to them. So he would have delivered them out of Egypt. The very God who spoke the law is the one who led them from Egypt and set them free from the yoke of bondage. Egypt represents a symbolic state of sin, and deliverance of the Israelites may be likened to God delivering all his people from the power of sin. God represents the records, or presents the records rather, of history. His resume, if you will, showing that he is creator, an everlasting friend, provider, promise keeper, deliverer, and savior. A resume is an introduction of one's qualifications and skills. It is an informational document that tells one's character story, outlining the details in an easy readable form. That is exactly what the Bible is. God has submitted his resume to us through the Bible in an application to be our savior. Isn't that wonderful, friends? The Bible is constituted in history. The biblical history moves in a linear direction from an absolute beginning when God created all things as shown in Genesis 1 to an ultimate goal when he will restore the earth at his second coming as shown in Revelation 21. The Bible assumes the existence of a God who personally acts in history. It doesn't try to prove that existence. And God states that I am what I am in Exodus 3 verse 14. The words express absolute and therefore an unchanging and eternal being. The very same notion expressed in our memory text, that he is timeless and self-existent. His origin is not important. We don't need to question his origin because it cannot save us. What is important is knowing and understanding his actions and purpose for being so intimately involved in the human race through time. So let us move on to Sunday, where we look at David, Solomon, and the monarchy. The monarchy of David and Solomon represents the golden age of Israel's history. But what if David and Solomon didn't exist, as some have claimed? What are the implications of that claim? If David didn't exist any at all, how would that affect us? What if the kingdom was not extensive as some have claimed, as described by the Bible? He had an extensive kingdom, the kingdom of Judah. So without David, there would be no Jerusalem, which the Bible accounts where he had claimed Jerusalem, the capital of the nation. In 2 Samuel 5, 6 to 10, without David, there will be no temple, which was built by his son Solomon, as shown in 1 Kings 8, 17 to 20. And finally, without David, there would be no future Messiah. For it is through David's line
that Messiah is promised. And we see this in Jeremiah 23, 5 and 6 and Revelation 22, verse 16. Now, just pause here for a minute. As Christians, if there was no David, there would be no Messiah. So basically, there's no foundation for our faith. There's no foundation for our religion. They would have to rewrite everything that we know because we would have no Messiah. And as the Bible says, Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. So we would have no basis for that. But let's look further to see if extra biblical references do corroborate the existence of David. On the subject of the epigraphal and archaeological evidence for King David, John Knox said, as the successor, King Solomon, little evidence has been uncovered to prove the historical existence of King David. However, recently discoveries, direct and indirect evidence provides greater substantiation for David's life and kingship. The most famous story of David and Goliath is depicted in 1 Samuel 17. Verses 1 to 3 gives a precise geographical description of the battle lines. The site of Keribet Kefa is located on the hills exactly in the area of the Israelites' camp described in this chapter. The recent excavations there reveal a massively fortified garrison city from the time of Saul and David, and this is in the 10th century BC, which overlooks the Valley of Eliah. Two contemporary gates were excavated. Since most cities in ancient history of Israel only had one gate, this characteristic helps us to identify the site of Sharaim, which actually means two gates, and we see this in 1 Samuel 17 verse 52. 1 Chronicles 4 verse 31 refers to Sharaim as being under the reign of David. So we have further confirmation of the existence of David. There's also the discovery of the Canaanite inscription of Eshbaal. Eshbaal is also known as Ish-bosheth, who is King Saul's son. And this is in 2 Samuel chapter 2. And is also King David's enemy, which is described in 2 Samuel 3 and 4. The discovery of the inscription from the excavations of Tel Dan in 1993 also corroborates or confirms the existence of King David. The inscription tells of how King Hazael of Damascus defeated King of Israel named Joram and a king of Judah named Azariah, who were both members of the house of David, which is how the dynasty of David is referred to in the Bible. So let's move on to Monday, where we look at Isaiah, Hezekiah, and Sennacherib. Isaiah 36, 1 to 3 and 37, verse 14 to 36. Or 38 rather, gives us an account of how Sennacherib, the Assyrian king in 701 BC, led a massive campaign against Judah under the reign of King Hezekiah. Sennacherib's journals, Annals of Sennacherib, validates the accounts of Isaiah 36, 1 to 3 and 37, 14 to 38. Also, in Sennacherib's palace at Nineveh, he celebrates his defeat of Judah, of the Judean city Lachish, by covering the walls of a central room of the palace with the relief descriptions of the siege and battle against the city. So we see here Sennacherib's account, which is extra biblical account, confirming the existence of Hezekiah through the
demolishing or plundering of Lachish. Recent excavations at Lachish have uncovered the massive destruction debris of the city after it was burnt by Sennacherib, but Jerusalem was miraculously spared, and we see this in chapter 37:14-38. Sennacherib is able to boast about this only as, and it in quotes, as Hezekiah the Judean, I shut him up in the city like a bird in a cage. And of course, he embellished it because he wasn't able to plunder Jerusalem as he did as Lachish. It is true that the city of Jerusalem was besieged, but the Bible records that the siege lasted only a day, as the angel of the Lord delivers Jerusalem in verse 36. This was a fulfillment of Isaiah's prediction, as we saw in verses 33-35. The deliverance of Jerusalem was the direct result of Hezekiah's prayer and supplication. There could have been a different turn of events if Hezekiah didn't besiege the throne of God. Isaiah 37:14 describes King Hezekiah as going into the house of the Lord and spreading it before him. So he laid everything before him. He agonized with God. So from this we can learn or take away that there is great power in prayer. Some archaeologists may argue or wonder, how is it that Lachish was plundered and Jerusalem was spared or untouched? But the answer is right there in the Bible, in Isaiah 37. So we see that so far the Bible's accounts for these events are true, or corroborated by the accounts of extra biblical or the archaeological evidence that we are finding today. Let's move on to Tuesday, where we look at Daniel, Nebuchadnezzar, and Babylon. The question is asked in the lesson, how do the early decisions of Daniel respond to the acts of God in using him as his servant and prophet to impact millions of people through history? When we look at Daniel 1 and Daniel 5, we can extract this from it. Daniel's decision to remain pure and undefiled by the king's food proved his loyalty and faith in God despite the circumstance. God found favor in his unwavering faith and endowed him with unmatched wisdom, knowledge, understanding, and his protection. And this couldn't go unnoticed by the kings that ruled in the various kingdoms throughout Daniel's time. Daniel purposed in his heart, as it says in Daniel 1 verse 8, to remain faithful to God in regard to what he both ate and prayed. Daniel stood firm in his belief. He stood firm in his religion. His decision to uphold the principles of God was never secret, and it made him outstanding in every way possible. He definitely was a sunbeam for Jesus, as we would normally say or encourage our children to be. It would be difficult for secular scholars to deny the existence of Nebuchadnezzar, because there's so much evidence surrounding Nebuchadnezzar. So the evidence speaks for itself. There are the excavations of Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar had his seal stamped on the bricks of the city. And it actually said on those bricks or tiles, Nebuchadnezzar, the eldest son of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, I am. So you can't doubt that Nebuchadnezzar existed. Nebuchadnezzar died peacefully in the city he had built and reigned for 43 years, but Babylon would not last even another 25 years after his death. The thing is, Nebuchadnezzar and Nebuchadnezzar, his father, built this city to heights of great recognition. And as we shall see, the city basically is in ruin today. So the city fell to the Persians in 539 BC, and this was prophesied in Daniel's vision in Daniel chapter 7. And later efforts by Alexander the Great never elevated it to the heights it had known under the reign of King Nebuchadnezzar. Today, despite the city's magnificent, beautiful, and phenomenal architecture, it's only merely an archaeological excavation site. And this is aligned with Isaiah's prophecy in Isaiah 13 verse 20 and Jeremiah's prophecy in Jeremiah 51:37. So let us look at Daniel 7 verse 4 as it describes Babylon as a lion with eagle's wings. One of the I guess you could say the greatest archaeological evidences is the Gate of Ishtar, which is a processional way up to that gate, and it's lined with 120 lions. Just to put it in perspective, I'll give you additional information. The lions represent Ishtar, which is a goddess of love and war. So the image of a huge lion pouncing on a man also was found during the excavation, and it still stands outside of the city today. These all testify to the lion as an appropriate symbol for Daniel, for Babylon the Great. Biblical history and its prophetic message are confirmed. There's no way to refute that. So Wednesday, the historical Jesus. The Wednesday's lesson starts out by questioning the identity of Caiaphas and Pilate. So who is Caiaphas? Caiaphas was the high priest and the mastermind behind the plot to kill Jesus. And Pilate, Pontius Pilate, was a Roman governor who gave the order for Jesus to be executed. But there is a follow-up question to who is Pilate. It further asks, how does Pilate's decision, or how is Pilate's decision most important for the Sanhedrin to accomplish its goals? So the Sanhedrin was very fearful of the backlash that they would face if they executed Jesus, because they were politicians. They were concerned about how they were seen amongst the masses. So it was unjust for them to put to death one who has done so much good. I mean, they could not deny the miracles and the healings that Jesus had performed. Therefore, the Jews were willing to save themselves from reproach. As many feared, as in many of those members of the Sanhedrin Council, they feared the scandal of an ill thing more than the sin itself. So they were concerned about their image in public more than them committing a crime or a sin against God. So Caiaphas' existence has been corroborated by excavations, archaeological excavations, as well as records of historians, specifically Josephus, who is a Jewish historian. His writing attests to him being installed and removed as high priest, to which places the events of Jesus's trial in his, Caiaphas's, rule as high priest between AD 18 to AD 36. The Many believe, or it is said, that Jesus was born around AD 0 or between AD 0 and AD 7, depending on which source you read. There is speculation about the exact date or time. But nonetheless, this is the first century AD, and Josephus's writings confirm Caiaphas's existence within that time, who was responsible for Jesus' death. Or the instigator of the crucifixion. Josephus's writing does not only confirm Caiaphas' existence, it also corroborates as it relates to Caiaphas not being the high priest. Peter and John were in prison. A position of high priest was, right? His record shows Roman officials appointing and removing high priests. So that confirms why Caiaphas was not the high priest during the imprisonment of Peter and John. In 1990, a family tomb was discovered south of Jerusalem containing 12 ossuaries or bone box. It contains the remains of people. The coin and pottery from the tomb dated to around the middle of the first century AD. The most ornate or the most beautiful or decorative of the ossuaries with multiple sets of bones in it contained the name Joseph, son of Caiaphas. Many scholars believe that this must be the tomb or the tomb box of Caiaphas, the high priest so directly involved in the death of Jesus. And there is also the inscription bearing the name of Pontius Pilate, the prefect of Judea under Emperor Tiberius. This was found in 1961. On a stone in a theater at Caesarea Maritima. Thus, in both cases, the principal figures or the main characters surrounding the crucifixion of Christ is corroborated by history or archaeological findings. All right, let's look at Jesus himself. Secular historians of the first two centuries also spoke of Jesus of Nazareth. Tacitus, a Roman historian, writes of Christ. His execution by Pontius Pilate during the reign of Tiberius, the early Christians in Rome, and early Christians in Rome. Pliny the Younger, a Roman governor, writes in 112 AD to 113 AD to the Emperor of Tarjan, asking how he should treat the Christians. Now, if there wasn't a Christ, or if there wasn't Jesus Christ, there wouldn't be Christians. And obviously this is after Christ's death, and during the time when Christianity was spreading like wildfire throughout the region. So we can essentially confirm that Christ existed. He describes them as meeting on a certain day before light, where they gathered and sing hymns as to a god. These archaeological discoveries and historical sources provide an extra non-biblical framework for the existence of Jesus, who was worshipped within the first 50 years after his death. The Gospels themselves are the primary sources about Jesus, and we should study them carefully to learn more about Jesus and his life. So let's segue into Thursday, faith and history. Coincidentally, I think it was 2 weeks ago, our senior pastor, Omar Oliphant, looked at the faith chapter 11 in Hebrews. So this should have been easy for many of us to understand. The lesson starts out by saying we don't live in a vacuum. Our choices influence not just ourselves but others as well. In the same way, the lives of many
of God's ancient people have had a great impact on the future of others beside themselves. In Hebrews 11, that well-known faith chapter, we see a summary of the influence of many of these ancient heroes of faith. So what lessons can we learn from studying their lives? Let's quickly go through them. So Enoch, in which Paul refers to in chapter 11, verse 5 and 6, we can basically summarize that he lived a life of faithfulness to God. If we have confidence in God like Enoch, in his fidelity, his truth, his wisdom, his promises, we can serve God wholeheartedly. And we can see the, or look back at the story of Enoch in Genesis 5, 22 to 24. Noah, who is referred to in Hebrews 11, verse 7, we can summarize his experience as faith lead the fear, or faith leads to fear and obedience of God, which leads to the justification unto righteousness. And we can see this being depicted, or Moses' life being depicted in Noah. We're talking about Noah. The faith of Noah led to the fear and obedience to God. Because, I mean, just imagine in the days of Noah, there was no rain and God told him that it would rain and he should build this big boat or this big ark. So we can see that story in Genesis 6 to 9. Abraham. Paul speaks of Abraham in verse 8. And his faith expressed in faithfulness, obedience. His story basically, Abraham was called by God to leave his land of Ur. He was a Chaldean and he should leave what he knew and go to a land that was promised to him. Abraham then called Abram left Ur in southern Mesopotamia, the most sophisticated city in the world at the time, and went out not knowing where God would lead him. And we can see that story in Genesis 12 and Genesis chapter 22. Sarah, Abraham's wife, Paul speaks of her in verse 11 of the faith chapter. And for her, we can basically say faith considers and rests in the truth of God's character. And this was borrowed from our dear pastor, Pastor Oliphant. And we can see Sarah's story in Genesis 21. Joseph's faith, he essentially evoked confidence in God's promises. We can see that aspect of Joseph's life in Genesis 50 to 25. Here Joseph is holding on to the promise of the land of Canaan that God swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Moses. Paul refers to Moses in verse 27. And we can summarize his experience or his exercising faith as faith refuses the temporal and embraces the eternal. Moses chose to become a shepherd leading God's people to the promised land rather than to become the king over Egypt, the greatest empire in its day. And we can see that story in Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. Rahab's faith. We can essentially say faith protects God's heritage even in danger. And this one was also borrowed from Pastor Oliphant. In Joshua 2 and 6, which gives the account of Rahab decided to trust the reports of God's deliverance, protected the two spies and became a part of the lineage of Jesus. Samson. Paul refers to Samson in verses 32 of the faith chapter. And in the words of our dear Pastor Oliphant, faith can reignite fallen dreams. And we can read the story of Samson in Judges 14 and through to 16. There is no doubt that Jesus and the apostles quoted the Old Testament, which means that it was real. Here Paul is making reference to the Old Testament as to the history of how these heroes acted by faith and how God intimately worked through their decisions. For Friday, we're going to wrap up here, and I'm going to leave you with a quotation in Friday's lesson by Ellen G. White from the book Education, page 173. The Bible is the most ancient and the most comprehensive history that man possesses. It came fresh from the fountain of eternal truth, and throughout the ages, a divine hand has preserved its purity. It lights up a far distant past where human research in vain seeks to penetrate. In God's word, only do we behold the power that laid the foundations of the earth and that stretched out the heavens. Here only do we find the authentic account of the origins of nations. Here only is given a history of our race unsullied by human pride or justice. So friends, we could discuss even more or other characters that can be corroborated by archaeological findings. But do we actually need archaeological findings to solidify or confirm the Bible? No. Because the Bible is essentially, or is the only book that I would say, it's the only book that can confirm itself. We have so much faith in the Bible because it's the inspired word of God. We don't need to go outside of the Bible to confirm the events that are recorded there. So, as we continue to study, let us pray that the Holy Spirit would open our minds and help us to interpret and understand the words of God, and that we look upon the Bible as history, God's resume of love and his intimate interaction with us and his longing for us to give ourselves in totality to him as we live our lives. Thank you for joining us, and I hope that you have a blessed Sabbath.
Lydia Saunders. Now, this morning I came to church for the first time in about 3 months, and I must say I'm encouraged by the work that has been done by the media team. After COVID-19, we definitely have to continue online church.
Let me begin by saying that God knows what he is doing. I really appreciate this online church. I think when online church was launched, it is the best thing that has ever happened.
So I've been on the AHG team for about 4 weeks now, and it has been a very interesting one, where I have been the production assistant, and I've done that for 2 days, then transferred over to being the online coordinator. And I tell you, it is very stressful, but I know I'm being helping to spread the message to other persons, and it is very, I think it's touching person, because even when I am at home and just relaxing, I know I'm being blessed, and during this time we need God the most.
We need to say a special prayer in our hearts for the team. This is hard work. What you see on TV is only a very small fraction of the work that goes into the production. The team is always organizing and trying to get the things properly put together so that they come over on time, the audio is right, the visual aspect is right, and it takes a lot of work. And so we should only just pray for the team, but I encourage us, those who can, let us find out from the communication team what is it that they need to, you know, to better be able to serve the church community, so that after this aspect of giving, we'll be able to share and to broadcast our Sabbath day worship on a continuous basis. It's also an expensive venture. They need new equipment. And so I encourage you, brethren, not just pray, but let us try and see where we can invest to help the communications team to help finish the work of the gospel.